G'day, I'm Dr. Peter Price of Classroom Professor. Welcome to this week's video in the Free Math Worksheet series. This topic this week is on improper fractions and mixed numbers. It comes from this ebook called Bring It On Book 3, Fractions Worksheet. So this is from the most advanced set of worksheets that we have in the Developing Number Fluency series, and it's for grade 5, or in Australia, year 6. So it's an advanced topic. It's looking at fractions. We know that students find fractions difficult. We know there are dozens and dozens of subtopics. If you include decimal fractions and percentages and ratios, there's just a mass of different questions that we ask our students to deal with, to tackle, and sometimes they find them very difficult. I've taught young adults that find fractions difficult. I've spoken to adults who aren't at university. You know, people generally find fractions difficult. So let's take our time. Let's develop the ideas, not exactly slowly, but methodically and in a way that students understand what's going on. Fractions topics of all lend themselves to symbol manipulation, or what, as I usually call it, mindless symbol manipulation. In other words, don't think about what it all means, just do this to all the numbers. We will ultimately get to that point, and you'll see I'll talk about that in a moment on the board, but early on especially, we want to help the students understand why it's that way, and if possible, use materials as I've got on the whiteboard to help the students see how the numbers relate to each other, how they connect together, and how it is that we get the answers that we get. I've seen far too many adult students at university who just don't get it and are confused and frustrated about it. Not to spend a little bit of time just recommending patience and, you know, care in helping the students understand what it means. All right, so we're going to have fractions like this one. Now, I should say I only have a limited number of pieces, so these magnetic pieces are beautiful, but I don't have lots and lots and lots of them, so I'm having to restrict the examples that I put on the board, but I'm sure you'll forgive me for that, and you'll see what I mean anyway. So here's an example. We have 1 3/8, so this is our initial fraction, which is a mixed number. Of course, mixed because we have a whole number and we have a fractional part. We're going to be referring to eighths an awful lot, because in this example, that's the denominator, and that tells us the size of the pieces. So that has a significant impact, obviously, on the answer that we're going to get. So we're going to record this as an improper fraction. And of course, that improper fraction will be in eighths. So the question to our students will be, how many would that be if it was all in eighths? All right, so that's where we're going with this. I'll just mention in passing, we're going to call this 3/8, even though it's a bit harder to get your tongue around the eighths rather than 3/8, which doesn't help anybody. It's not the correct name for the fraction, and if you say 3/8, it does nothing to trigger an understanding of what size the pieces are. 3/8 is like, you know, a spelling exercise. All right, so 1 3/8 is how many eighths? Now, the symbolic method, which I'm sure you know, is to multiply the 1 by the 8 and add 3. There's our answer. Boom. However, that does, as I said, it doesn't help students to understand where that comes from. So we're going to want to help our students see how we get an answer. What on earth are we doing here? How does it make sense? So let's, first of all, refer to the number of eighths in a whole. So we can put the eighths on the board. Of course, we can count them. I hesitate to say it's obvious. I don't think it is obvious to students. I remember teaching elementary or primary level students years ago, and we were talking about sixths, and I said, how many sixths are there in a whole? And basically no one in the class knew the answer, and I thought, why not? It's so obvious. And they hadn't made that connection. So we want to help the students make the connection. They're called eighths. Why? Because there are eight of them. Why do we write an eight here? Because that's the number of pieces in the whole. They're all equal. They're all called eighths. There are eight of them. Okay, so we've established it. Now, if I had different materials, I would put these on top to show that those eight eighths equal the same as the whole. But these magnetic pieces don't actually stick like that, so you'll have to take my word for it. So there's 1 3/8. How many we're going to have, I'm not going to draw all over the magnetic piece, but obviously there are 8 here and 3 there. We're slowing this down just for emphasis, I suppose. The answer is going to be 11. I would like to help the students see that this is 8/8 and this is 3/8, and of course that makes 11/8. And notice I'm saying 8 all the time. That is quite deliberate, because that's the name of the fraction. It refers to the size of the fraction, and we want to continually emphasize that. And the fact that because we're referring to 8 in both of these terms, then we can add them. If this was some other sort of fraction, or indeed if it was just a whole, you'd have to do something else to it. But if they're all 8, we can have 8/8 and 3/8, just as we can have 8 oranges and 3 oranges, and we can add them all and we get oranges. Okay, so that basic idea. Okay, so that's not terribly difficult. Let's do another example. Only this time we'll go in the opposite direction. So this time we're going to use some sixths. So moving on to a second example, this time we're going to start with an improper fraction and convert it into a mixed number. As I said before, I don't have a large number of these pieces. In fact, I only have enough sixths to make up one whole. So I've drawn around them. Let me label them as well. So these are all 1/6. I would want the students to see that these are the same size. I don't want to try and pretend that I'm doing anything untoward. Let's move the eighths out of the way. All right. So here we have a number of sixths, and we're going to find out what this comes to, what this is equal to as a mixed number. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 sixths. What will that number be? So over here we're going to write 13 sixths equals something. Now it will be a whole number, of course, and a number of sixths. And so we want our students to work out what the answer will be. Now, in the worksheet, it refers to a division method, which of course is the standard way of working this out. So we're going to divide the 13 by 6, which is a division fact with a remainder. 13 divided by 6 is 2 remainder 1. It's going to be 2 and 1/6. Okay, so that's out of the way. We knew that's what the answer was going to be. But how can we help our students understand that, rather than just jump straight into symbols? Because I'm convinced that it's at this point that people get confused. Not because that's a terribly difficult example, or that they couldn't do a page full of these in their workbook or their worksheets, but because they'll get it mixed up with other processes and they will forget, and then, you know, in years to come they'll go, I can't remember how to do that, and it's all very confusing. So I would rather help the students understand what it all means. So let's use the pieces that we do have here and put them together and say to the students, what do you see? How many sixths do I have here? Obviously it's 6/6. So 6/6 is a whole, so we might record that. 6/6 is one whole. All right, how many sixths do we have here? 13. How can we use that information to help us figure out all of this and work out how many wholes and sixths we have here? Now, I know that if you were to do this with your students, by now half the class would be jumping out of their seat saying, well, that's too easy. That's if they're that enthusiastic. Jumping out of their seat saying, I can do it, I can do it. I know what the answer is, I know what the answer is. But we want to help them understand why it will take a bit of time. And even though they can see what it is in this example, we're going to give them more examples where it will take more, you know, more effort, and there's more chance of getting it wrong. So let's just take our time. So 6/6 is a whole. There's one whole. Do we have enough here to make another whole? Now that's a very similar question to one we might ask using base 10 numbers when we're adding, and we add together, for example, 6 ones and 7 ones, and we get 13. We don't immediately write 13 down. We say, oh look, do you have enough there to make into a group of 10 if you have 13 ones? Of course you do, so you regroup. This is a lot like regrouping. Do we have enough here to make another whole? Yes, we do. we can make six of these into another hole. Obviously, I can't move the ones that I've drawn, so I'm going to draw a rough loop around them and say that's another hole as well. So there's one hole here, one hole here. It's also six thick, so let's say that one equals six sixths, one equals six sixths, and one sixth left over. So here's our two, whoops, and here's one sixth. I apologize for my board writing. I have injured my shoulder and it's rather sore. Okay, so that's the process. It is going to take some time. It is going to require some thinking on the part of the student. So I was going to say exploring. It's not necessarily exploring in the sense of discovering a whole lot of things new, but it is discovering how it works. So we want them to get to the point where they can look at an example like that and go, I can do that. It's easy. It's just division. I can divide 13 by 6. I get 2 and 1 left over and blah, blah, blah. But we want them to be able to always picture it in their mind. So if we say 17 fourths or 17 quarters, then we want them to go, okay, I know 4 fourths or 4 quarters is a whole. So if I divide the 17 by 4, that gives me 4 wholes, because I know 4 fourths are 16. There's 1 left. It's going to be 4 and 1 fourth and 1 quarter. So we want that train of thinking, that train of logic, to be available to the students so that they're not simply remembering some routine, but they're thinking about what it all means and they can get the answer correct. Okay, that's it. We've come to the end of the video. I look forward to talking to you next time.